So we're continuing this morning with our series, How to Be Christian in an Election Year. And let's take a moment, let's pray together before we get started. God, for all your great gifts to us, we give you thanks for the opportunity to live in a nation where we can worship, where we can have political conversation, where we can express our opinions. We are grateful. We pray that you never let us take these things for granted. We pray this morning that as we think together about our responsibilities to each other as Christians, as members of your church, as people who have been called by you, Lord, we pray that you'd be at work in our hearts and in our minds, in our hearing and in our understanding. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So we find ourselves once again in a week of incredible turmoil in the world. We heard about the coup attempt in Turkey, something around 200 people killed there. We heard the news out of Nice and France, just an unbelievable and grisly attack where over 80 lives were lost. And for the people of France, where they're experiencing this as the third such attack in 18 months, really has become something of frightening regularity for them. And so we pray for the people of France and for people throughout the Middle East who live under the control of ISIS. We are in this struggle at this moment with a force that is only bent on death and destruction, who use their version of faith, their version of Islam, as a club against people who live under their control, and who then try to project that hate and that destruction out into the world through the use of modern communications. And one of the things that I think that I learned from this is the power of words to shape what people do. If we don't think that words are important, if we say, well, talk is cheap, well, perhaps it is, but at the same time, we see how much damage talk can do when it's used in the service of hate. So it's critical for us who believe in a God of love, who believe in a God of life, who believe in resurrection, believe in forgiveness, to keep on proclaiming the gospel, to continue to speak words of hope, to continue to speak words of blessing and grace into the world, to not give up, to not succumb to despair or hopelessness. We have to trust that our words and our actions, as small as they might be, make a difference in some larger way to what the whole world experiences. Now, I know that that's difficult. It's difficult for us to imagine that something that we do, that something that we could say might make a difference. The past 2 weeks, trust me, have tested my faith as well. And as we get into this next little bit of time, these next 2 weeks, with the conventions approaching, we know that the political rhetoric in the United States will just get more fierce. If we've seen Republicans and Democrats tear each other apart now for the past several months, now we look forward to them tearing each other apart across the aisle, right? And we can't exactly look even to the church for a place that's free of discord. We learned on Friday evening that the Western jurisdiction of the United Methodist Church. So we elect bishops in the United States through a series of jurisdictional conferences. And in the Western jurisdiction, we've elected our first openly gay bishop. Now, some people will greet this with great excitement and enthusiasm, and other people will say, wait, we just agreed to keep talking. What does this mean for our agreement to keep talking about this? So no one's quite sure what's going to happen next. We really are in uncharted waters as far as the denomination goes. But I trust that in the next 1 to 2 years, it will become very clear whether or not we can stay together as one denomination or whether we will have to split. There's no question in my mind that our ability to talk to each other over the next 2 years will hold the key as to which way we go. And that's true, our ability to talk to each other and how strong it is the thing that's going to make a difference in the church staying together. It's going to make a difference in us breaking through the kind of political gridlock that we've experienced the past several years. It's going to make a difference in our ability to work on the problems of race that we've been talking about, our ability to rebuild relationships between police and the communities where they serve. It's going to make a difference even in our ability to combat terrorism, as far-fetched as that sounds. But think about it. What is radicalization? We talk about radicalization. What is it except words that are being fed to someone and that change their mind and cause them to go out and do something? If one side can communicate that message, is it not also possible for us to communicate a counter message? Is it not important for us to do so? But what we need to learn is a different kind of communication. One that's not about blaming each other, one that's not about shaming each other, one that's not about condemning each other. One that's not even about argument, per se, but one that's about a simple affirmation that I find here in today's scripture. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. We live to the Lord, and we die to the Lord. Whether we live or we die, we are the Lord's. And what I mean by that is we often think of ourselves as independent agents, as people who exist out in the world when we go out beyond these doors, that what we say and what we do, it reflects only on us, right? I don't think so. Not according to this passage, anyway. What we say and what we do reflects on, in no particular order, this congregation, the United Methodist Church, Christians everywhere, and Jesus Christ. What we say and what we do reflects on all of them. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. Now, no one feels this, or at least ought to feel this, more keenly than a preacher. So when I stand up and I talk to you on a Sunday morning, I do not take that lightly. But can I make a confession? There are times when this understanding of my calling is burdensome. And there are times when I want to lay it down and have the freedom to say whatever I want. However I want, perhaps with as many expletives as I want. I want the freedom to be angry. And when I feel that way, I feel mightily justified in kind of searching around, casting about on Facebook to find some political argument that's being made somewhere that I really disagree with, that I can just go in and pick a fight with somebody that I don't even know. I feel tempted to do that sometimes. Do you feel tempted to do that sometimes? There are two problems with that. The first one is very practical. Have you ever genuinely been convinced by someone who launches a direct attack on you, whether in person, face to face, over email, or on the internet? Ever been genuinely convinced? No one has ever been convinced or had their mind changed by something that's written in all caps on Facebook, ever. Trust me, there's been, I read a study on the internet. It just doesn't work. But there have been lots and lots of friendships that have ended over it, right? And many family members who've suddenly found themselves on the outside because of something that they said. I watch friends engage each other in these kind of sarcastic arguments all the time. Like, just people trying to assert their intellectual superiority, their witticism, their ability to just rhetorically smack someone else down. I see people doing this, and I just want to take them aside and say, why? To what end? To what end are you arguing with somebody you went to high school with? What do you care? Really? I want to remind them, for the sake of everyone's sanity, that it is possible to keep scrolling. And furthermore, if it becomes too burdensome for you to scroll, that it's also possible to mute them. You don't even have to take that step of unfriending them. Just mute them. It's possible. You can do it. And again, I'm very tempted sometimes. I can't count the number of times I've spent 10 minutes writing something to make it perfect and then backspaced over the whole thing and said, no, I really don't want to do this. I do that because I remember this one thing. We do not live to ourselves and we do not die to ourselves. So there's an authority that I am answerable to, that we are all answerable to, that's greater than the congregation, that's greater than the district superintendent, that's greater than the bishop. Our final authority over us is the one who called us to begin with. We do not live to ourselves and we do not die to ourselves. We will answer to the one who gave himself up for us. And today's scripture speaks to that as well. Who are you to pass judgment on the servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they will stand or fall. So Paul talks in this passage about welcoming those who are weak in the faith, but not for the purposes of quarreling over opinions. Now, that phrase, weak in the faith, is somewhat unfortunate because it really sets up this idea that there are an inferiority and a superiority. What that Greek word that we translate as weak literally means is, and the way that it gets translated in other places in the New Testament, is as feeble, infirm, sick. Like when people are bringing the sick to Jesus, the same word gets used. So it's not flattering at all. And what Paul's talking about is people who are on opposite sides of these disputes that were really important in the early church. So in the marketplace in Rome, it's talking about the idea that some people will eat meat and some people will only eat vegetables. And you say, well, what does that have to do with anything? Well, in those days, most of the meat that was for sale in the marketplace had been slaughtered as part of a ritual that took place in a pagan temple. And so when it came into the marketplace and was being offered for sale, some Christians perceived this as, well, if I buy that meat, I'm participating in this cultic ritual that I don't want to be a part of, that's idolatrous. And so they said, you know what, I think I need to be a vegetarian, because my conscience won't let me eat this meat. Some people had that problem and some people didn't. Later on, if you keep reading in this chapter, it talks about some people abstaining from wine and some people not. Again, this has been an issue that's historically riled the church. We don't use wine in communion, right, in the United Methodist Church, in part because we've historically taken this very strong stand against drinking. If we keep going, you read about Some people judge one day to be better than another. Other people judge all days to be alike. And we don't know exactly what's meant by that, but some people think as they read it, well, it's probably referring to the idea that some Christians were still celebrating Saturday as the Sabbath. Others had moved on to Sunday. Other people maybe were not celebrating the Sabbath at all. And so the question is, what day is most important? Paul's belief was that people who kept scruples about these kinds of things were not yet fully mature. That's the perspective that he's coming from. If you had scruples about all these different things, you're not yet fully mature, he says. And that's his distinction between the weak and the strong. And again, I would say that's an unfortunate distinction because I don't necessarily believe that. But I do think that maybe what you could say is when you think that your scruples need to be enforced on everyone, maybe that is the place where we might say, okay, that's a mark of weakness. In other words, when we can't find a place where we can agree to disagree and keep going and say, you know what, I view this one way, you view it another, but it's all right, you're still my brother, you're still my sister in Christ, and I love you. We can still be in ministry together. We can still serve alongside each other. We can still support each other. That's the mark of maturity. That, to me, would be the mark of strength. And those are the kinds of people that you can have a conversation with, even a political conversation. Not for the purposes of trying to convince them to see it your way, but for the purposes of trying to understand where they're coming from, what they've experienced that's led them to the place where they are, to get some insight that maybe you don't currently have. I'm not averse to talking with people in the church about controversial topics. I'm not averse talking with people in the church about politics even. But I want to know before I enter into that conversation that I'm not entering into some sort of a gotcha game. I have to understand first that someone's primary purpose in asking these questions is really for understanding. These are people that I would call people of goodwill. Maybe that's a better substitute, a better idea than those who are mature or those who are strong or weak, but people of goodwill. Jesus refers to these kinds of folks as people of peace. And so when he sends the disciples out two by two to do ministry in his name, he says, go into a village and find someone of peace. And when you find that person, stay with them. Let them offer you hospitality. And that's what it's about, hospitality between people. People of peace can understand that not everybody's going to see things the same way, but we can still love each other. So mainly what I think that I've put forward so far is a very simple idea. Don't be a jerk. Other people in the other service are complaining. Well, you know, that's a pretty simplistic message, is it not? Well, okay, that's fine. But if it's so simple, then why are we not doing it? So I guess that's our challenge. On social media, in person, don't be a jerk. Now, if you want it in more proper Wesleyan terminology, you might say, do no harm. So Wesley, when he set up what were called the Methodist societies, he had three simple rules. He had tons of rules. Trust me, he had lots of rules. The three that really were the general rules, and everybody who comes before the annual conference to be ordained is asked whether they know the general rules. And these are three. First, do no harm. Don't be a jerk. Second, do good. Third, do whatever it takes to stay in love with God. Do no harm, do good, stay in love with God. So a big part of doing no harm, I think, is understanding that no opinion that you have is universally shared by all people. I often hear people in the church speak this way as though what they're about to say is self-evident and everyone must agree to this particular point. But trust me, not everyone agrees. As someone who stands up here and does this every week, trust me, not everyone agrees. There's almost nothing you can say that everyone will agree on, except perhaps, maybe if I make this statement, it might be a winner. Jesus good, sin bad, right? Maybe I could say that, maybe that would work. But don't assume, especially here in this place, that everybody sees it the way that you see it. That's one of the key things that we need to bear in mind if we want to do no harm. Another part of doing no harm is for us to be more inclined to walk away from an argument than to start an argument. Certainly walk away from any argument that's more likely to produce heat than light. In other words, any argument that's more about raised voices than raised awareness, you want to walk away from. Now, there are some important exceptions, I think, to times when you want to walk away. First one is, I think you need to be willing to challenge people who generally are on your side politically when they begin to use rhetoric that's either really inflammatory or just downright untrue about the other side. Because they're not going to hear it from somebody on the other side who comes back to them. But they might hear it from you if they know that you're generally in sync politically. Remember what I said, that our words matter. And if we don't want the other side to demonize us, we also can't participate in their demonization either. Again, you need to pick your battles carefully. But certainly anyone you know well and with whom you've had political conversations before, I think you can pull them aside privately and say, hey, that thing that you thought was so funny that you posted on Facebook, yeah, I'm not so sure. You need to be able to have those kinds of conversations. But again, privately, because no one appreciates being called out in public. Remember that idea, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Remember, that's kind of important to us as Christians. That's what I'm getting at. But second, and I think that this is where I want to leave it, is that every person will find a line beyond which they cannot go. Everyone has that line. There will be an issue, a way of approaching a problem that you just cannot accept. No one would ever say that Paul was not a person of principle. He certainly was, but in this passage, he's arguing for working with all kinds of people, accepting into the community of faith all kinds of people. But certainly he and we cannot accept everything. There are certain things that are just not within the realm of what we're willing to deal with. But in drawing those lines, here's the caution that I want to offer you. You have to understand what it is that you may be losing if you take that stand on principle. We may keep our principles, but we might lose our friends. We may keep our principles, but we may cut off a member of our family. And so before you do that, it's important to take a few moments to pray about, is this really worth it? Is it or no? Do I value this principle more than I value this relationship? Those are some hard questions. But that's the lens through which we need to see all of these approaches to these problems. So I challenge you in this election year to hold fast to this principle. Don't be a jerk. First, do no harm, if you prefer to remember it that way. There are 113 days between now and the election. 113. What do you think? Can we promise God and vow to each other that we'll do everything we can not to be jerks?